Lord, I come before you now, and I come on behalf of my friends, on behalf of this congregation, and Lord, we ask you to use your Spirit, to use your Word, to minister to our hearts and to our souls. There are probably some here this morning, Lord, who just from the circumstances of life, from the swirling winds around them, that they might feel a bit weary. There are others that have experienced real joys and real reasons to celebrate as they've seen you at work and they've seen you bless. There's a variety of things that are going on in the lives of each that are here today. But we all come together with one request, and that is that we want to hear from Jesus. And so, Lord, we ask you now to take your word and to encourage our hearts, to help us run it well, but to finish it, and to finish it in a way that glorifies you. God, I ask you now that you would just simply take these words that are spoken and that you would craft them and make them something that is useful and in line with your heart, in line with your will. May you simply make them useful to those who hear them, clear and easy to understand. And may the end result be, as we leave this place, that we all say that we have a wonderful Savior, that we exalt the name of Jesus. Speak to us now, we pray. We want to hear from you. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you could choose just one metaphor to describe your life, which one would you choose? Would you choose maybe a beautiful day at the beach? Maybe because of the circumstances in your life, maybe you might choose the opposite. Maybe it's a chaotic hurricane that seems to be tearing the beach apart, that seems to be eroding the sands. There's probably 1,000 different descriptions that you and I could come up with. The question really is, which one best fits you, best fits where you find yourself? In my life, my experience has been that those metaphors, those descriptions, they change from season to season. Early on, I would have described my life a bit like the World Cup for those of us who live here in Europe, or maybe for some of you who are from the States like I am, maybe a bit like the Super Bowl. The reason was because I always found myself in competition with my younger brothers. We were always trying to up the ante on the other. As I entered early adulthood, I would have described my life a little bit more like a great fog. I was kind of without direction, and I really was having a hard time seeing my way forward. I didn't know where I needed to go. In the next season, I would have described it maybe a little bit more like a mysterious package that you get in the mail. You don't know where it came from. You don't know who sent it to you. But it's a exciting thing, because even though you don't know what's inside of it, you're excited to discover it and discover what the contents are. Now I find myself in a completely different season. It's kind of a wonderfully surprising season, full of vistas that are just beautifully laid out in front of us. From my vantage point, the views in my wife and I's life are truly remarkable. There's extraordinary peaks to be climbed, even if it means, on occasion for some of us, having to walk through some rather deep valleys. You know, as we come back to the book of Hebrews, the author, he uses a completely different metaphor to communicate his next lesson. But I find something interesting about the metaphor that he chooses. It's a metaphor that doesn't shift, it doesn't change, it stays constant. We see this in many places throughout Scripture. The Christian life is described in some places almost like a battle, like a war that we are in. Thus, Paul challenges his protege, Timothy. He says to him to serve well, like a good soldier of Jesus Christ. We see this in 2 Timothy 2:3. that also describes it a bit like a boxing match. Paul actually tells us, he says there to those in Corinth, that we need to box in such a way that it's very clear that we're not just swinging away wildly at the air around us. We see this in 1 Corinthians 9:26. Additionally, in many other places, Paul describes the Christian life almost like a slave or a servant serving his master. You know, each metaphor that is used to describe our experience, our journey in the Christian life, each one is meant to describe a journey from beginning to the very end. Now here in Hebrews 12, the author, he uses a different metaphor. He uses a metaphor that is to describe exactly the same thing, but the one that he uses here is of an athlete who is running a very long marathon. Yes, it's going to take us to many places. There's going to be many turns along the race route. There's probably going to be some hills that we have to climb, and there's going to be some deep valleys that we're going to have to walk through. But it is a marathon nonetheless that each of us must finish. His admonition to us, the writer's challenge, I believe could not be clearer for us this morning. If you're going to run this race, if you're going to be a participant, if you're going to get involved in the race, run it to win. Don't just get up every day and go through the motions. Don't just get up every day and simply do the things that you do. Instead, get up and face the day with purpose. Face it with determination that you will win, that you will be victorious. Here in chapter 12, I believe what we see is that the author, he lays out for us a game plan for victory. If we're going to win this lifelong race that we all find ourselves locked in, what is it then that we must do? What are the things that we must apply so that we can find ultimate victory? So with that in mind, let's begin by going to the text that Tom read for us a moment ago and ask a really simple question of that text. What is then the believer's game plan to attain ultimate victory? Victory in Jesus. What is the game plan that we have to apply? I believe as we make our way through it, you're going to see that there's four parts to it. Four things that we have to do. Four things that the author lays out for us. The first is that we have to apply the encouragement. We got to apply the encouragement that we receive from those around us who have ran the race well in the past. The great American poet, Ralph Waldo Emerson, he once said the following, "Each man is a hero and an oracle to someone else." You know, all the heroes that, as we made our way through Hebrews chapter 11, and if you were here with us, you might remember as we studied about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Joshua and Gideon and David, we went through this whole litany of heroes of the faith. Each one of them, they spoke very loudly. They spoke very loudly. Their examples spoke very loudly to the next generation, to those who actually received this letter from the author as he wrote it. Their lives stood as an example to those who believed, as well as an example to those who were unbelieving. Their example of faithfulness became a great motivating factor in each of their lives. And might I suggest that the examples of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, the examples of the patriarchs, they become an example to each one of us today as well. Thus, the reader is challenged to, if you will, apply or utilize the example of their life, the example of their heroes, to find ultimate victory. Let's begin by looking at, we're going to look at something short. We're going to hear initially, we're going to look at some phrases rather than verses, whole lumps of scripture. I want to look at the first phrase of verse 1. So if you will, join me there. Hebrews 12, 1. "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. Such a great cloud of witnesses. You know, the statement isn't long, but it does say an awful lot. As followers of Christ, we have been given in Scripture an incredible litany of men and women all throughout the book that went through great trials and tests and difficulties, hard experiences, but they did so faithfully. You know, even in the worst of cases, they stared down death. They did it without despair. So when you look to their examples, not only must we learn from them, but might I suggest we need to ask, what should we learn from them? You know, I believe as the writer was writing this, what he was essentially saying to those who would have been reading it would have been something like this. You should run your race just like Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Joshua and David did. Run it in faith. You know, they ran, and they ran, and they ran some more, and they did it with less light than you and I have this morning. You realize that? They ran well because, you see, the Messiah, he had not yet even appeared, yet they continued to run in faith, believing that he would come. They were victorious because they trusted in faith, every single one of them. You know, the idea here, as you look at it, the great cloud of witnesses, it's an idea of a great cloud or a great gathering of those who are examples to each one of us. You know, sometimes we tend to think of this verse when we read it as, I guess you could say, a great cloud of witnesses that need to be entertained, so to speak, by us here on earth. It's like we're at a great sporting event and they're up there cheering us on. But might I suggest, we're not here to perform for our grandparents and our friends who have passed along to heaven. Instead, we should see their lives, if they knew Jesus Christ, as a great example for us to follow. You know, I can't speak for you. My grandparents are all with the Lord today. My last grandparents passed away a few years ago. But I don't know about you. Have you ever had the experience where you thought that your dearly departed grandparents maybe were looking up and are up in heaven and looking down at you and watching what you're doing? You know, there was a time in my life where I actually did think that way. Like, I was thinking they were watching everything that I was doing, and it's like, I don't want to disappoint them. Maybe for you it was another loved one. No matter who it was, in either case, I felt as though, and maybe you felt as though, that their eyes have been squarely focused on you. If you've experienced such, can I suggest something to you? If you've looked to this passage here in Hebrews 12 to think that somehow that this justifies that sort of thinking, I gotta love you enough to say that that's not actually what this passage teaches. It teaches something completely different. As a matter of fact, if that's what it did teach, can I also suggest that if it did teach such a thing, that that probably wouldn't be very motivating to us. For a lot of us, it might actually paralyze us. If I thought that my grandma was watching some of the things that I do, I guarantee you that would make me want to cower in fear and go crawl into the corner rather than to think that she was going to be proud of everything that I do. Additionally, we know from Scripture that Scripture teaches us not to live for the pleasure of any single person. I'm not here to live for the pleasure of my grandparents. I'm not here to live for the pleasure of anyone in this room. We are all here to live for the pleasure of one, right? We're here to live for the pleasure to please Jesus Christ. See, Paul knew that, and he knew that so well that he says that he made that his chief ambition. That was his number one goal in life. We know that because he says so in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9. We make it our goal to please him. To please Jesus Christ, whether we're at home in the body or away from it. Therefore, can I suggest that our heroes, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, David, all the litany of heroes that we read about in Hebrews chapter 11, your believing family that are now with the Lord, all of their examples, every single one of them, they are there to motivate us to do what? To live lives that please Jesus Christ. They shouldn't paralyze us. they should cause us to want to seek to honor Him. So the first thing that we clearly have to do, the first thing we have to do is to allow their examples to help us. Well, what's the next part of our game plan then? What's the second part of the game plan that we must apply for ultimate victory? Can I suggest that it is also that we must amputate the encumbrances? We have to amputate the encumbrances. And we see this in the second phrase in verse 1. There in the second phrase it says, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely. Every sin that so easily entangles us, if you will. That's how another version states it. Once again, this isn't a long statement. It's not wordy. But the challenge should be clear for us to understand. It's about getting rid of those things in our lives that keep us from successfully running our race well. I remember when I first became the pastor of this church, this was going quite a ways back. I've been the pastor now for 13 years, and I remember one specific occasion where early on, God hadn't blessed us with all this beautiful equipment that you see up here on the stage. We had Stuart, you might even remember the small little box that came apart with little microphone or little speakers on both sides of it. And there was all kinds of leads and wires kind of crammed into it. And I remember one specific occasion where I had the chore of taking all those microphone leads and trying to separate them. And I think there must have been at least 10 of them that had become kind of intertwined with each other. I don't know if you've ever had an experience like that, but if you have, you probably know from firsthand experience that that can be a real exercise in patience. Something like that, an experience like that that should have only taken a minute or two was still tormenting us 30 minutes later. But, you know, as frustrating as it was, the thing that was actually most disappointing is it kept us actually from accomplishing our greater goal. We were doing all that because we were trying to set up for worship, and we weren't able to set everything up because everything was kind of intertwined with each other. You know, our lives, I've learned, can be a lot like that tangled mess. Sometimes the things that bind us, they're good things, but they keep us from the best things. At other times, the things that shackle us are our own sinful choices and habits. In either case, what we see here is that the author encourages us to set those aside, to get rid of those things that entangle us and keep us from successfully running our race. Paul says exactly the same thing to a lot of his friends as he writes to them. In Ephesians, in the book of Ephesians, he tells them there to do exactly the same thing when he says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22, that you were taught to put off your old self. To put off those things that entangle you, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires. He tells us to get rid of those things that are tainted, things that are of this world that keep us from running well, those things that are corrupt, that are found deep down inside our heart. He says to get rid of those things. You realize that Paul saw this as such serious business. This was so vital to him that Paul actually goes so far as to say to those in Colossae, when he wrote his letter to them, he actually says to them to put them to death. He says in Colossians 3:5, he says there, put to death therefore what is earthly in you, sexual immorality, impurity, passions, evil desires, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Why was this so very important for Paul? It was important because he knew that if they did not do this, he knew that it would keep them from ultimate victory. So it was vital for Paul that they learn to do this and do it well. Victory was all that mattered to Paul. Paul wanted to cross the finish line, and he wanted to do it well. So no matter what the sacrifice was, he was willing to pay it. You know, when we are unwilling to do that, when we are unwilling to make similar sacrifices just like Paul, we're unwilling to put off the encumbrances, put to death our sinful habits, the things that are weighing us down, that are keeping us from winning our race, those things that entrap us. Do you realize that when we are unwilling to do that, do you realize what the result is? The result is that we unwillingly or unwittingly, we actually sacrifice our victory. It keeps you from being victorious. kind of similar to a Olympic sprinter who several years ago had won the gold medal in the 100 meters. Several months after having done this, he went to another event where he was participating, and as it got to the final heat to qualify for the final round, he didn't qualify. Well, after not qualifying, the press wanted to know, well, what was it that kept you? I mean, you're one of the fastest men in the world. How is it you couldn't even make it to the final heat? He simply said, I was too heavy. I was out of shape. Before the meet, he had eaten a little too much, enjoyed life a little too much, and trained a little bit too little. He hadn't gained a great amount of weight, but it was just enough to keep him from qualifying. You know, friends, often we think of the encumbrances, those little things that we know we need to deal with in our lives, those habits that we keep saying, we're going to make a change here. One day I'm going to do it different. We keep thinking of those things as little. They're just not a big deal. But can I suggest an extra meal here, an extra pound there, and you don't qualify for the final race? So let's not allow the small things, the little things in our lives, let's not let the small things to be the very things that disqualify us, that keep us from qualifying for the final race. Let's do just as Paul said to those in Corinth when he said in 1 Corinthians 9:25-27, every athlete exercises self-control in everything. They do it to receive a perishable wreath. But you and I who know Jesus Christ, that are in the race for our life, why do we do it? We do it so that we can receive an imperishable one. So Paul says, I do not run aimlessly. I do it with purpose. I do not box as one beating the air, but I discipline my body and I keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I should myself be disqualified. Let's be certain, friends, that the small things don't keep us from finishing our race. Let's not let them disqualify us. But what's the next part of our game plan? We've talked about the first two. Now let's look at the third. And we're going to see that in the third phrase of verse 1. But the third part of our journey, the third thing that we must do to find ultimate victory is simply this. We must choose. We must be determined to finish the event. We got to finish our race. We have to determine, no matter what comes our way, that we will persevere. We will finish. In verse 1, it says the following there, in the last phrase. And let us run with endurance the race that's been set before us. You know, the admonition should be absolutely easy, plain to see. It is to finish the race. Even if you feel like quitting, even if you're exhausted, even if you've had enough, it's to finish. That's what it means to endure. It simply means you are exemplifying for everyone to see the determination to keep on going. Even when everything in you is screaming, even when everything in you is saying, I've had enough, I just want to stop, I just want to rest, I just want to quit. No, endurance keeps pressing you on to the finish line. That's what running with endurance means. Many years ago, when I was still in high school, some of you know I played basketball. You've heard me tell a little bit about that story. And I remember one particular experience where my basketball coach had this brilliant idea, or at least he thought it was. He had this brilliant idea that he was going to train a basketball team by entering them into a cross-country meet. I don't know if any of you ever run cross-country before, but that's a different experience. Typical race is about 5 kilometers. May not sound like such a big deal, but for those who are training for basketball, it's a lot bigger deal than you might think. Well, when the event came around, I remember it well. The guy raised up the starter's gun, the gun rang out, and I sprang out of there like a hound dog being, or like a rabbit being chased by a hound dog. I mean, I just took out of there just running like the rabbit out in front of everybody. I was taking the lead. I was off, and boys, I'm running along. I'm like, well, this is going well, and I'm in first place, and I'm thinking, this is good. Then I got to about halfway, about the 3rd kilometer, and all of a sudden, man, my side is not quite what I thought. It's starting to hurt a little bit, and I'm starting to cramp up. By about the fourth kilometer, I'm telling you, my lungs were burning something awful. By the time I got to that finish line, I crossed that finish line, and I'm telling you, I thought I was going to cough up a lung right on the spot. I learned that day that running cross country is a whole lot different than running up and down the basketball court. But you know what else I learned? All that pain and all that my body went through, I determined I was not going to quit. I was going to finish the race, that I was going to persevere no matter what it took. Even if I lost my lunch, I was going to cross the finish line. You know what? That's exactly what the writer's challenging you and I to do as well. He's challenging us to do the same thing. When Paul wrote to his friends in Corinth, it was interesting. Because you see, he knew that many of them had started their race really well. But if you've ever read through the book of 1 Corinthians, you know that they started to get off track pretty quickly. They were being tempted as a result by the things in the world around them, and some of them were actually being tempted to quit their race. The newness of their faith was beginning to wear off as the problems of life around them began to swirl and as it began to rise up. So they started to lose their, so to speak, their enthusiasm for Christ. They were being tempted to return to their old lives. So Paul, as he writes his letter to those in Corinth, he challenges them, finish your race, finish well. He says to them the following in 1 Corinthians 9:24, do you not know that in a race, everybody runs? Everybody's at the same place before the starter's gun rings out, aren't we? We're all right there. We're all in the same position. There's no first, second, or third place. You're all in the same place. Everybody is running. Question isn't whether everybody is running. The question is everybody running to try to win the prize? And that's what Paul challenges them to do. He says, don't just run, but only one is going to get the prize, so run in such a way that you are the one who gets the prize. Run to win. We shouldn't just be content, friends, to be in the race. Yes, it's good if you're in the race, but don't just be in the race. Be in the race to win. When I was playing basketball, I'm going to tell you, I remembered I was very competitive. Because I was, I wanted to win. If I had a teammate that I heard had no interest in winning, believe me, I would have hoped that he would have gone and played for someone else. I wanted to play with those who wanted to win. Friends, it's the same for us. If you're going to run, run to win. Finish your race well. Finish the race that Christ has put you in well. Well, finally, what's the last part of our game plan? What's the last part of our game plan if we want to know ultimate victory in Christ Jesus? Can I suggest that we see in verses 2 and 3 the most important part of it? And that is simply that we have to follow our example. We got to follow our example. Join me. Let's look at verses 2 and 3 as we wrap things up. There in verses 2 and 3 it says, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God in heaven. Consider him, Christ Jesus, who endured for sinners such hostility against himself. Why did he do it? Notice what he says. He did all that so that you and I, each one of us, that we might not grow weary in the middle of your race, so that you might not grow weary, so that you might not get faint-hearted, so that you might not lose the ability to finish. He wants you to finish your race well, so look to him, look to his example. You know, in running, as in many other sports, I've learned something. Your success and failure has a lot to do with what you actually focus on with your eyes. Raz, you play basketball, right? You know, it's interesting. I learned playing basketball that as you play, you can actually keep your opponent in front of you if you focus on the right thing. Focus on the wrong thing, and your opponent will get right by you, right to the basket, and he'll score every time. I learned when I was playing basketball, if I would focus on my opponent's waistline, he couldn't juke me. He couldn't get by me. But if I started to focus on his feet or the ball or on a different part of his body, that guy would score 100 points on me. It all had to do with where I kept my eyes focused. You know, it's really similar for the runner as well. When you're running, if you look down at your feet or you look behind you to see who's coming up behind you, it's going to throw you off stride, isn't it? It's going to throw you off stride and you're going to lose it. And then before you know it, somebody's passed you and you've fallen behind. You know, it's similar for us in our race, in our lifelong race. We're called to keep our focus squarely on Jesus. We need to focus upon Him. We need to focus upon His example. You might ask why. Can I suggest that the life that He lived and the death that He died stands as the best example of all for us to follow? He showed us the way. He left us the example. We dare not look to the world for the example. We're going to lose our stride. We're going to lose our way. But if we keep our eyes on Jesus, we will never lose our way. Christ pretty much told His disciples this when He said to His disciples in the upper room the following. He says to them there in John 13:15, He says, I've given you an example. Remember, He was up there washing their feet and He was showing them what it looked like to serve. He says, I've given you an example that now you should do just as I have done to you. He was simply saying, I've showed you the way. Serve one another the same way that I have served you. Fascinating to me. The Apostle Paul, who was used by Christ to plant many churches all throughout the early world, he was used by God to bring many people to Christ. He learned from Christ's example very, very well, so well that when he was writing to those people back in Corinth that we were talking about earlier, that were losing their way, that were losing their heart, that didn't want to continue on, that were being tempted to quit, when he was writing to them, Paul writes them, and he invites them in their race to continue on, to press on in all their struggles, continue on, finish, and do it in such a way where you imitate Christ, where you follow His example. How do we know that? Listen to what he says in 1 Corinthians 11:1. Be imitators of me as I am of Christ. You know, the only one who's worth our imitation, the only example that's truly worth us following, is Jesus. We dare not look to the world. We dare not look to others around us. Instead, we keep our eyes sore. We keep them squarely fixed upon Him. We must look to Him if we're going to finish our journey well. You see, Jesus is the one who served. He taught. And He showed all who would receive Him. He was the one who showed the pathway to the kingdom for us to follow. He glorified the Father in every way, and might I suggest that He glorified Him best in His death, when He died for our sins upon the cross so that each one of us could come to know Him. Thus, our ultimate example is found in Jesus Christ, our Savior. And He is the one that we should be keeping our eyes focused upon in our race. Well, what's required of us? What's required of us in our journey if we're going to finish it well? What's required of the game plan if we're going to be able to finish it and finish it well? First, have we not learned that we have to apply the encouragement that we received from those who preceded us? We have to apply the encouragement that we received from Abraham and Isaac and David and Joshua, the saints of old, of our godly family members who are no longer with us. We must look to their examples and learn from them. But we also have to get rid of the encumbrances, don't we? We have to be willing to amputate them, to do surgery in our lives, to get rid of the things that are weighing us down, that little bit of extra weight, just like that sprinter. We have to be willing to get rid of those things because they keep us from qualifying, from finishing. We got to get rid of them in our lives. Third, we've also learned we have to be determined to finish. We got to finish. It's great if you started well, but just like that race that I was running in, boy, I took off, I took the lead, just like the rabbit running out in front of everybody. But boy, I'll tell you what, it doesn't matter how you start, does it? It's all about how you finish. Finish well. And finally, follow your example. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Look to him. He is the example for us to follow. You know, many years ago, the Olympic Games, as we still know them today, now, some of you might not know this, they actually originated not too far from here. They originated down in Greece, in ancient Greece. At that time, when the famous season of games first began, for the very first time, not only did they begin, but a lot of the traditions that still surround the Olympic Games were started. They were instituted all the way back at the first set of games. One such tradition that was instituted at that time was the Olympic torch. If you've watched the games, you've seen the person run into the stadium with the torch, and they take the torch and they light the grand torch there in front of everybody, and it's an extraordinary, it really is a magnificent, marvelous event. That all started during the first games. But you see, the reason it goes all the way back to the first games is because during the first games, they had a rather unique event. It was an event, it was a race, but it was a race where every runner carried a torch of their own. They had to carry the torch as they ran. But what was interesting was the goal of the race. The goal was not necessarily to be the first one to cross the finish line. The goal was to be the first one to cross the finish line with your torch still lit. Friends, I can't think of a better example of the Christian life. Isn't that a grand example of what we are called to do? I want to run this race to win the prize. I want to be the one that Jesus looks to and says, well done. But I want to get to the finish line with my torch blazing away for him. Amen? How about you? Do you want to do the same? That's what Jesus has called us to do. So let's run to win. Let's do so in a way where God gets the glory every step of the way, and we get to the line, to the finish line, and we hear him say, well done, and our torch is blazing brighter than it's ever blazed before. I believe that's how Christ wants us to finish. He wants us to finish well. So run to win. Don't just be part of the event. Run to win with your torch blazing away for the glory of God. I hope each of us determined to do that. Let's be part of the winning team. Let's be those who seek to hear him say, well done, my son. Well done. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this passage in your word. It's simple. It's not overly wordy. It's not overly complex. But there's a lot of meat there. There's a lot of things that we can take and chew on and apply in our lives that will help us in our journey, that will help us in our race. Some of us, Lord, as we listen this morning, realize that there's some spiritual surgery that we need to do. We realize that there's some things in our lives, there's some encumbrances, there are some things that are clinging on that we need to get rid of. We need to change some sinful habits. We need to get rid of some things that are weighing us down and keeping us from the best in our lives. Lord, we ask you to help us to do what is necessary. There's others amongst us this morning, Lord, that are just weary. Life has beaten us up. We're tired. And as a result, some might even be thinking of throwing in the towel. God, help them. Help them to determine that I'm going to persevere. No matter how painful it is, I want to get to the finish line. God, help each one of us as we run. Not to be looking at anyone else around us. Not to be comparing ourselves with our neighbors, with another person here in the church. But to be looking to you, to be looking to our audience of one, seeking your pleasure and your pleasure alone. Lord, might you be glorified in our lives as we run, as we seek to win, and as we seek to do so in a way that truly pleases and exalts Jesus. Help our light to shine. We pray this in Jesus' name.